Before we get started, just a short disclosure. I do a lot of research for many companies, some of whom are listed here. And as always, always thank them for their support. So I'm a teacher, I'm a researcher and a prosthodontist. If you look on the QR code, you can find me there or you can search me out on Google Scholar. I come from Dalhousie University, which is in Canada, and it's right on the east coast of Canada. And we do get snow there, although I'm pleased to report that at the moment the snow has all gone and we're experiencing spring-like weather there. I originally trained at the University of Michigan and graduated from there in 1984 and then moved to Canada and did my doctorate in dental technology in Sweden at the University of Malmo. Okay, let's kind of move into the topic a bit now, and some things that you may not be aware of, and that is that according to the WHO, worldwide, oral diseases accounted for 357 billion in direct costs and 188 billion in indirect costs. It's a staggering amount of money. And yet the amount of money that's spent on dental research is a pittance compared to how much it's costing. In the same report, they said that $90 billion was spent on the treatment of oral diseases across the European Union. And this was the third highest total among the non-communicable diseases, just behind diabetes and cardiovascular disease. So just kind of keep that in mind about how prevalent oral disease is and how little money it actually gets. Now, little interest people pay on oral disease. So I do a lot of research on dental curing lights. And this is me in between patients, just catching a few rays. But seriously, I've seen many changes in 43 years when I've been working in practice and using curing lights. First of all, started out with UV curing, and now we've moved to the modern curing lights with mainly the LED variety of curing lights. But you can see the lights have changed a lot in the size, ranging from the large pistol grip guns that you see on the right down to the very sleek pen style lights that you see on the left. Now, light curing is everywhere. We use light curing for our bonding, our resins, our cements, our ortho, our crowns, our sealants. We use lights for pretty much everything we have in the modern dental practice. And there was a survey published in 2020 in the American Dental Association, and they were reporting on the usage of curing lights, and 59% of visits involved a curing light. And what was interesting is that when you look at the eye protection use, you see that only 37% of those visits were the eyes of the patients protected. The dentist did a slightly better job of protecting their eyes, but the patient's eyes weren't. A little bit concerning that. And in the same report also, they reported that in 50% of the cases, the dentist made no adjustment for the material shade or opacity. They just cured everything for the same amount of time. And in 21% of the cases, they didn't adjust for thickness either. They just cured everything for the same amount of time. So I'd like you to think a little bit about what's going on when we light cure. And I always like to use analogies. So I'm thinking here of an iceberg. Just think, you can only really see the top of the iceberg, but you can only really test the top of the filling. There's no way you can test what's going on beneath the surface. And so when you're baking a cake or making some muffins, you can always kind of test the top. And you're fortunate because you can then tip the stuff out and you can have a look at the bottom and you can see if it's cooked or if it's burnt. But you really don't know unless you, tip it out or stick something into it. You obviously can't do that with a composite resin. So just think about the fact that when you're looking at the effects of your curing light, all that you're doing is just testing the top and you've got no idea what's going on beneath the surface. Now, not all curing lights are the same. And I always get a kick out of listening to people talking about, hey, my bond strength is better than your bond strength, and oh, mine's 34 and yours is 36 megapascals or something like that. It's really a farce, because you got to recognize that you can very easily double your bond strengths with using the correct amount of light. And if you don't use the right amount of light, then the bond strength just falls through the floor. So the curing light can really affect your work, and not all lights are the same. Lights have to be maintained. The angle and distance affect the irradiance received. Bulk filling, bulk curing requires close attention to your aim and the health of your curing light. And short exposure times can certainly cause a problem when you are light curing. Ultimately, that comes down to the loss of income, if you have a problem, dollars and cents. So this was a study that was published, 16 years ago by Burgess's group. And they showed that you could very easily go from a bond strength of below 5 megapascals to well over 20 by just delivering a little bit more energy to the restorations. Okay, so having kind of laid some groundwork there about the curing light and how important it is and how the curing light might affect your bottom line, let's just talk about the curing light as a hazardous thing in your practice. And we published a paper a few years ago on shedding the light on a potential hazard, which was the curing light, of course. And what most people don't recognize is that the curing light emits a lot of blue light. And for those of you that have got an iPad or a phone, you've probably seen that at nighttime, it dims, or the color changes, becomes more yellow. And the reason why it does that is because Samsung or Apple don't want to get sued because of the amount of blue light that they're emitting. Now, of course, the amount of blue light that comes from a phone is a fraction of what comes from a curing light, or from your LED headlamps, or from your operatory light. So just kind of pointing that out, and you might want to read this, and you might want to look up the blue light hazard and think about dental curing lights. Because while you may not care about your eyes, you may care when your assistant or your patient sues you. Because they say that they've been exposed to too much blue light. The other thing I like to talk about is buy beware when buying products online. This was published in the March issue of JARDA. And basically it's telling you, guiding you, look, be really, really careful about buying stuff online. Because there is very, very little control about the products that you might purchase. You might buy a bonding agent that's been on the shelf in some hot warehouse for a year, and the bonding agent doesn't work anymore, or the composite may not cure very well, or the impression material may not set. Or worse than that, the dental handpiece that you buy may explode and cause problems for a patient. If you don't believe me, just wait for a few more slides. But something that I learned when writing this paper is that actually neither the FDA nor Health Canada actually test any products. I always thought that something that had FDA approval meant that they actually tested it, but actually they never test them. They only respond when there is a problem. So it's basically a case of filling in a whole ton of paperwork and checking all the boxes. And if you do all that and you pass and you get your clearance, 510K or approval, depending on kind of what level you're working for or working at. And then the next thing that's really important for you to realize when you buy stuff online from an online seller is that the web hosting company takes absolutely zero responsibility for the products they sell. And if you don't believe me on that, let's look at a few things that might come up in a minute. Now, the reason why all this is important to you is that dental curing lights are medical devices. And the use of an unregulated and untested medical device on a patient is really in vivo testing on a patient who hasn't given informed consent. And let's face it, I mean, nobody wants to have a breast implant that hasn't gone through any kind of testing procedure. And really, by the same token, nobody wants to have a filling material or a dental implant or a bone graft that hasn't undergone any kind of testing. And yet, if you buy something online, that may very well be the case. So for those of you that are out there saying, hey, I've got this good, you know, sweet deal, it's $50 for the curing light, and I've got my implant here for half the price, you really got to think twice. You know, are you using a licensed device or not? We've all seen these stories with, ear pods and scooters exploding, the batteries in them. And whenever you fly now in aeroplanes, they're always giving you cautionary tales about your lithium-ion batteries. Well, you have to remember that curing lights use the lithium-ion batteries as well. And basically, if you're not careful with an unlicensed device, maybe your practice burns down. Or maybe it explodes next to a patient. Now, none of these are dental issues that you see here on the screen, but these are all potential things that could happen if you buy an unlicensed device. As I mentioned about dental drills before, you may say, oh, well, that'll never happen. You know, my $50 drill is just as good as the $500 drill. Well, this was a case that happened in the UK a few years ago. And let's face it, nobody wants to have this, on the press coming to their door. And the problem is that these, as they say, extremely dangerous drills look identical to a reputable brand. And the same thing applies that, you know, the curing lights and bone grafts and such like, it's kind of hard to tell. And what was concerning here is that in the UK, they'd actually seized more than 700 counterfeit drills in the last 4 years. I wonder where those 700 drills were going to go. Well, this was taken from the US Customs and Border Protection website. And in 2021, they reported that they found hundreds of shipments of fake and unproved medications, cosmetic treatments, and liposuction machines in a raid that they did. So it happens in the UK, it happens in the States, it happens across the world that we're facing an epidemic of unlicensed devices being sold online. And as I said before, the online sellers like eBay and Amazon take zero responsibility for the products they sell. And if you don't believe me, well, go and look at the websites down below. I've cut out the various sections from their agreements. And you can see here that in clause 6 of eBay, they have no responsibility or liability for all the safety or the performance of any product they list to sell. And eBay was facing a situation in 2020 where people were trying to make them liable, and they successfully prevented that from happening, because they said it would harm sellers. Amazon says exactly the same thing. They are not liable. And in fact, the services are provided as is. So as is. Interesting. So to protect the public from that, I noticed that one of your senators, Chris Murphy, introduced the bipartisan legislation to get counterfeit medical devices out of the USA. And I wasn't able to find out if this thing has passed. I saw it from December of 2021, but you might want to look to see whether or not this has been enacted. So before you go and click buy on that $50 curing light, for which 9,000 actually have been sold, think twice about, is it really worth the risk of running afoul of the FDA? And the news corporations come knocking at your door or your practice burning down. Just be aware of these things. Okay, please be careful. So moving on to the dark art of curing lights, here we can see four different curing lights. Popular ones, Celadux 3, Elipar Deep Cure, Blue Phase 20i, and 20i, and the Velo Grand. And the point to make here is that they all actually have a different light output. They're all different. Now, some of you may think that you get to the point where you've spent all this time in a nice restoration, and now's the time to relax, and my assistant can do the light curing while we have a little conversation. That's really very far from the truth. Light curing is not easy, actually. You need to do it properly for it to work well. So you're probably at this point saying, oh, for goodness sake, Dr. Price, just shut up and tell me what light to buy. Well, I can tell you that the Velo is an excellent curing light. The Deep Cure is a good light. And also the Smart Light Pro is a good light. Those are good ones. There are many other good ones on the market, but we've tested those and consistently we've found that the Smart Light Pro, the Deep Cure S, and the Velo have all proven to be excellent curing lights. I said before that I like to think of light curing using analogies. So I like to think about baking. And when you're baking a cake, what's the first thing that you usually do? Unless you're a real expert at it, you follow the recipe. So when you're light curing a composite resin restoration, the first thing I recommend you do is read the instructions so you can follow a recipe. The manufacturers do a great job of providing you with instructions for use. Read them. Next thing you need to think of is, what are you putting in? In other words, you know, what's the oven like? You know, is it a gas oven, electric oven? Is it a microwave oven? You know, what are you putting in? Most of us think more about what we're putting into our cars than we think about what we're putting into our restorations that help us buy the cars. So let's just think now a little bit about what we're putting into our restorations. Well, here we can see an example of the visible spectrum, and we are putting in blue light. And blue light that's mainly in the 450 to 470 nanometer range. Now, I know that there is a new light on the market called the pink wave, which also provides light in the infrared region as well. That's really a new light, and that's a little bit of an anomaly. We have conducted several studies on that light in our laboratory, but they have yet to be published. So here we can see the emission spectra from different curing lights. And in the bottom right-hand corner, you can actually see the pink wave down here. And you can see it's got an emission spectrum that peaks at around about 633 nanometers. And then also another one that peaks at about 857. And you can't see that because that's in the infrared region. But you can see that all these curing lights, they're all different. Some have got violet light, some are just blue, some have got kind of a blue-green light as well. So we have a situation now where we have curing lights all delivering, or pretty much all of them delivering different emission spectra. So you can have two lights delivering exactly the same power as we see on the screen here, but the squiggly lines describing the emission spectra are really quite different. And if we look at that in a little bit more detail, we'll see that one of the lights delivers 806 milliwatts. Now, this isn't milliwatts per centimeter squared. This is just milliwatts of power in the blue range, whereas the other one only delivers 540. Even though the total power from both lights is the same. Now, the reason why this light only delivers 540 is because it is a polywave light with two peaks, and the rest of that light is in the violet range. So if your composite just requires blue light and doesn't require any violet light, even though these two lights are exactly the same, then this light here is going to perform way better than this light here. even though one may be a fancy polywave light and the other one is just a regular blue light. Because the regular blue light is actually delivering more blue light than the fancy light. That's why it's important to know what you're putting in. Now again, just like baking a cake, we want to get an even bake. An even bake means that the light tip must cover the entire filling, or else you have to cover the filling with multiple light exposures. Just because the entire tooth is kind of glowing doesn't mean that it's getting an adequate amount of light. It's kind of like a convection oven, or when you place the cake in the oven, it has to be in the right spot sometimes, otherwise it doesn't get an even bake. We're going to cover that a bit more in a minute, but just think about that. Now, if the recipe says bake a cake for 30 minutes, starting at 350, most cooks would follow that recipe because they know that that's going to work. But I know that dentists will say, well, can I bake the cake in 15 minutes at 700? Well, why not? You know, should be able to do that. I should be able to speed it up. But most cooks will tell you that if you bake a cake for 15 minutes at 700 degrees, then it's going to look kind of burnt on the top. So the answer is no, you can't. You need to follow the recipe. So what about these new 1 second lights that are out there? Some of you may have heard of the Monet laser curing light. And there's no doubt that these laser lights do cure composite. There's no question the top surface of the composite resin is cured with the laser curing light. But the question is, what's the bottom like? And in studies that we've done in our lab, we've found that the bottom of composite resins cured with the laser curing light is not as hard, is not as well cured as if you were to use a conventional curing light such as the Velo or the SmartLight Pro for 10 seconds. So it's kind of a guarded answer here. What about the 1 second lights? Well, they do work, yeah, but they don't work as well as a good conventional light. And I stress the word good conventional light there, used for 10 seconds. And the other thing just to think about is that if you miss the target for 1 second in a 3 second exposure, you know, that's 33% less energy. So if you're going to do a short exposure time, then you have to be bang on the target. So just kind of keep that in mind. Now, I always like to call this the radiance game, and this gets the manufacturers very annoyed because I talk about it as being a game because every manufacturer does this. They say, my light's better than your light because my light delivers a higher radiance than your light does. Well, that is just wrong. And I'll explain why in a second. Here we see two lights. One is the Velo on the left. The light on the right is another light. And you can see there's a difference in the size of the light tip there. So let's go back to this. How often do you hear this, the 2000 milliwatt thing? So we hear this all the time. It is just plain wrong to say that one is better than the other based upon the irradiance. You can have a laser that has got a very high irradiance and yet the power is not very high. And again, we see that picture of those two lights with a big tip and a small tip. And you're probably asking me now, why is he showing that picture? What's the importance of that picture? It must be something important, otherwise he wouldn't keep on showing it. He wouldn't keep on going back to saying it's just plain wrong in red. Let's explain this. So a high radiance does not mean the light is powerful. Irradiance is power divided by the area. Irradiance isn't power. So small changes in the diameter of the tip have a huge effect on the irradiance. Let me show you why. Here we can see some lights and they're gonna range in power from 471 up to over 2000 from the Velo Grand. in terms of watts. I'm not talking about irradiance, I'm talking about watts. So when you think about that, it's kind of like a microwave oven, you know, which is, you know, there are differences between a 500 watt microwave oven or a 1000 watt microwave oven. Now, admittedly, these are milliwatts, but that kind of gives you an idea of some differences there. So I told you that there's a huge range in the power. Well, let's look at the effect now of that on the irradiance. If I change the tip diameter, okay, from 10 to 7 millimeters, and I deliver the same power. Now, remember, I showed you that the power was ranging there from, 400 up to over 2,000 milliwatts per centimeter squared. So I picked a number of 1,000, since that was kind of like in the middle of that range. And if we take the power of 1,000 and we divide that by the area, then the irradiance of the light is delivering is 1,273 milliwatts per centimeter squared. Now, if I change that tip diameter to 7, then even though the power is exactly the same, the irradiance is now doubled. So it's gone from 1,273 to 2,597. So that is why, for somebody to say, my light is better than your light because the irradiance is higher, is incorrect. The only way you can say that one light is more powerful than the other is to report the power. So you need to start asking the sales reps, what's the power from that light? And again, I like analogies. So I think we're all aware that high-heeled shoes or boots put a lot more pressure on the floor than a flat shoe does. So a 3,000 milliwatts per centimeter squared light does not mean it's a powerful light. It may just be a small tip and delivering higher pressure over the tooth. So just think about that. So that is why I was showing the picture of the two lights, the one with the big tip, the one with the small tip. The big tip represents the flat shoe, and the small tip represents the high heel shoe. Which one do you want? So obviously we want to have a big tip, because what is beyond the tip or is in shadow may not cure as well. We want to cover the entire surface of that filling with light. Otherwise, we might end up light curing it 3, 4, 5 times. I'll show you more of that in a minute. So, a light tip that does this is not a great job, is not a great light, and I certainly would like to have a light that doesn't completely cover the tooth. So, large tips versus small tips. So here we can see two different curing lights. And we are looking at some pretty pictures, and the pretty pictures are actually beam profiles, which I'll describe more in a second. And they show the light covering the tooth. And you notice that one of them has got high pressure in the center, which high pressure is plenty of black and red. And whereas the other one is plenty of yellow and a little bit of red, which is indicating a nice even coverage over the entire surface of the tooth. Here we can see the beam profile being used to estimate how many light exposures you'd have to do to fully cover a restoration. And on the left-hand side, it's just going to be two exposures to do a complete coverage. Whereas the light on the right is going to require 5 exposures. So do you really think you're going to do that? Think about all the cost savings that you will enjoy by just having to do 2 light exposures. And maybe with an even bigger tip, you could just get away with 1 light exposure. So if you can cover the entire restoration with a light tip, such as you can see here from the Velo Grand, then that's great. Now, those pictures that I showed you were made using what's called a beam profiler. Now, beam profilers describe how the light is distributed from the light source. They're not unique to dentistry. In fact, they're called laser beam profilers because they're designed to measure lasers. But I and a few colleagues have changed them around a bit, and now we can measure curing lights with them. And basically, a beam profiler is a digital camera, and it takes a digital picture of the light output. And it's got some filters in it so it doesn't get saturated, but I won't get into that now. But here we can see an example of a beam profile. And this is an example of a real curing light with a good beam profile, and an example of a poor curing light with a poor beam profile. And these are all real curing lights that you might buy tomorrow. Now, here we can see an example of a curing light called the BS30. And it's got a beam profile similar to the one that I just showed you in comparison to the Smart Light Pro, which has got a much more even beam profile, even though it is more uniform across the surface. So it's more uniform across the surface, big surface coverage, but much better light than the one on the left. Here we can see more examples of beam profiles being superimposed over teeth, because those pictures that you just saw really didn't mean too much unless you have some kind of clinical relevance. And once again, now you can see, hey, maybe Dr. Price is right. I will have to use the light on the left multiple times to achieve a reasonable coverage of the tooth, whereas the lights on the right, hey, I might just have to use them twice, depending on how large the restoration is. So think about that and think about why beam profiling is really important and how many coverages, exposures you have to do to either cover a full beautiful composite veneer that you're doing in the front, or maybe an MOD restoration in the molar in the rear. So just think about that. So, really important, think about the beam profile. I've had a great day today talking to the researchers here at Dental Advisor, and the dental advisor here, we've been discussing beam profiling and why it's important. So we published a paper, I think last year on this, where we looked at the effect of beam profiling and the effect of curing composite resins that didn't have a good beam profile versus those that had a good versus bad beam profile. And we can see here that with a poor beam profile, you do a great job of curing in the center of the restoration. And it's interesting, if you look at that, the width of the good curing is about 4 millimeters. And that just happens to be the width of the ISO mold that's used for depth of cure is 4 millimeters. So if you use a depth of cure mold for this particular light and composite, it would look just fine. But if you use a wider mold, or if you think about a tooth that is wider, then you notice that it really falls off at the edges, and the edges wouldn't be so well cured, especially at the deeper regions of the tooth or the filling. And remember what I said at the beginning, it's just like an iceberg. You can touch the top surface, and the top surface in all these cases will be nice and hard. But the bottom, especially in the corners here, is not gonna be that good. So here we can see a study where we used a variety of curing lights. And on these different curing lights, we made a tooth mold. And the top line just shows the beam profile. And we can see here that the Celalux 3 actually has a bit of a narrow beam profile. I'm sorry, the pictures of the top have got kind of squished, I think, with my face there. But it's got a kind of a narrow beam profile, and that narrow beam profile equates to a nice hard center in the middle of the tooth, but not so good at the edges. Whereas you see the Vila Grande on the right does a much better job of curing. And if you increase the exposure time to 20 seconds, it does a really nice job curing the restoration. Still not great in the depths of the proximal boxes. And as we all know, those are the hardest places to cure, which is why they recommend you do supplemental curing from the buccal and lingual after you've taken the matrix band off. And it's just possible. I mean, we don't know, this is an example of a clinical case where a tooth was extracted and lo and behold, there was caries in the corner of this particular composite resin restoration. You notice that the top of it looks perfectly okay, but the bottom you can see where there's obviously been some leakage and some caries there. Now, the question really is, now, why do we see that happening? Well, it could very well be that the material just wasn't cured down the bottom there. And remember what I said, it's not just is the composite resin hard, it's also the bonding agent. So if the light doesn't get down there, then the bond strength's gonna be weaker. And if the bond strength's weaker, then they'll get leakage and then they get caries, and that's the reason why you see this. So it's just possible that that happens. So it's not just a case of being soft there and you being able to scoop out the composite that's there. It's also the bond is really going to be very, very weak down there. Okay. So when you are reading the instructions from the manufacturer, most manufacturers do recommend times, but just remember that those are under ideal conditions. And remember that the first increment in the proximal box can very easily be 4 to 8 millimeters away from the light tip. So you may have to give a little bit longer exposure time over the proximal boxes because of the fact that they're further away from the light tip. But just remember that can also provide more heat and there's no composite there. You're just dealing with the bonding agent. So you do have to be careful. I recommend blowing air across the surface, especially when doing the critical photo activation of the bonding agent. And it's important to figure out the effective distance because the effective distance is different from different curing lights. Here we can see two lights, one delivering a tip irradiance of 1,400 and the other one delivering a tip irradiance of 2,400. So you may think, oh great, I'll go and buy the one that's got a tip irradiance of 2,400, it must be better. But actually, because of the design of the light, it could very well be that 6 millimeters, the light on the left has only declined in irradiance down to about 1,200. Whereas the light on the right has exhibited a sharp decline down to 850 milliwatts per centimeter squared. And let me tell you, these are real lights that are out there. It all depends upon the optics. And the budget lights especially have exceedingly poor optics in them. And we've seen the type of appearance you see on the right very often with budget curing lights. Now, this is a clinical point, and that is, angles do have an effect, and small tips have an effect. Obviously, with a small tip, if you don't cover the entire restoration, the area on the right is going to be in shadow, and you're not going to get that cured. So we see that all the time, and it's possible there can be a shadow as well, if the preparation's got some shadows. But if the tip is angled, and especially if there is a metal matrix band present there, then the effect can be even worse with even less of the restoration being light cured. So you may say, okay, well, that's fine. I can understand that angling of the tip can have an effect. So what? Well, why is that important? Well, the important thing there is that pretty much all the research that's done is done under ideal conditions. And very, very, very few researchers actually do what you see on that top image where you see the light at an angle. Now, some do, and some papers have been published on it, and the results are pretty appalling when we look at the results that they produce. So, okay, so I told you that it's important to keep the light perpendicular, to the surface of the restoration. I told you, kind of watch out for shadows. Even, you know, if you think there might be a shadow in the prep, you know, do an extra exposure and move the light. And just remember, light travels in a straight line. So, you know, it's just like painting a wall. You're going to have to make sure you cover all areas with it. Because if you don't do that, and, you know, this is what the light tip looks like when it's over the surface, you're going to get this. And here we can see the effect of inadequate curing. Basically, the entire proximal box didn't get cured here. And even on this side here, where there was a metal matrix, it didn't get cured very well. So always keep that in mind. So when you are going to a sales booth and the manufacturer or the sales rep is trying to get you to buy their curing light, ask them if they have a mannequin there. And nine times out of 10 that they will have something. And what you want to do is you want to open that mannequin as wide as you think a patient who maybe has trismus or a child might open their mouth. And then see, can you get the light in? It's a very simple test to do, but just think about it. Can you get the light in there? Here we can see the Valo curing light, and yeah, I can get the light all the way back to the last molar. But here we can see a competitor light, and gee, look how wide the patient has to open to access that last molar at perpendicular. Just look at that. So, you know, while you may see a study that says, hey, these two lights are the same, they work great, you always got to remember that was done in the lab under ideal conditions. So think about access, and you want to think about a light. Can I get the light into the mouth? Look for a low profile head. Really important. Here we can see another light. You know, it's not quite so bad, but it's still pretty tough. And the worst one we've seen is this particular light, which was a budget curing light. The patient had to open 65 millimeters in order to get that light in to the second molar tooth. It wasn't even the third molar, it's just the second molar. 65 millimeters. Excuse me. As I mentioned about baking a cake, it's important to read the instructions, because sometimes different shades require different curing times. Just like different cakes require different curing times, or different pans require different curing times, different composites require different curing times. And here we can see an example from the Dentsply SmartLight Pro curing chart. Now, I agree that most of it is just either 10 or 20 seconds, but you kind of need to know that, right? So read the instructions. And here we'll look at the instructions from Filtek Supreme. So if you take the body, enamel, or translucent shades, then the 2 millimeter increment is in 20 seconds. And they recommend the minimum irradiance should be 400. And so you multiply that by the 20 seconds, and that gives you 8 joules per centimeter squared. So they're recommending that you should deliver 8 joules per centimeter squared to your resin restorations. Now, interestingly, if you look at the Denton shades or the A6B or the B5B shades, so they're the body shades, but they're the darker body shades, then first of all, the increment can only be 1.5. And then the exposure times now need to be 40 seconds. So now the body is going to require 8 joules. Okay. Well, sorry. So Okay, I made a mistake there. So got the wrong slide in there. So we can see here, I'll explain it to you now. So we can see here that it's 400 times 20 seconds, but it's now actually going to be 400 times 40 seconds, which is going to give you the 16 joules. And that 400 times 40 seconds, which we see here, is obviously double the amount of energy. And it's also only an increment of 1.5. But the key point here is to think that these two recommendations from the manufacturer talk about delivering between 8 joules per centimeter squared and 16 joules per centimeter squared. Now, to deliver 8 joules per centimeter squared from a curing light in 10 seconds means that the curing light has to deliver an irradiance of 800 milliwatts per centimeter squared. So 800 milliwatts per centimeter squared times 10 seconds gives you 8 joules. To deliver 16 joules per centimeter squared in 10 seconds, let's say, for example, the light would have to deliver 1,600 milliwatts per centimeter squared. So sorry, there was a slide that was missing from that. Let's try to explain it a little bit better. But the point I'm trying to get across here is that different composites, different shades of composites, require different amounts of energies. But the energy that they're delivering, what they're requiring, is somewhere between 8 and 20 joules per centimeter squared, somewhere in that region. Okay. And that if you want to deliver between somewhere between 8 and 16 or 20 joules per centimeter squared, then the curing light has to deliver 1,000 milliwatts per centimeter squared or 1,600 milliwatts per centimeter squared, somewhere around about there. Anyway, sorry about that. Okay, so I'm just going to start to wrap things up a little bit now, and I'm going to give you some what I'd say take-home messages from the presentation. And that is, the first thing is that light curing and curing lights are really important to your practice. 50% of the times when you see a patient, you'll be using a curing light. So please do read, understand, and follow the instructions for use that the manufacturers spend a lot of time and energy and money developing. They're very useful, and you can work out how long you need to bake that cake for if you read the instructions. The other thing I'd like to say is please pay attention when you're light curing. Make sure that all of the composite resin restoration is covered by the light tip. If it's not fully covered, then approach it from a different angle. This is a device that I invented several years ago. It's called the Mark Patient Simulator. And we've used that extensively, and it's been published by numerous authors, all finding exactly the same point. And that is that if you don't pay attention when you're light curing and the curing light moves off target, then you very quickly start out in the right place. And then there's a bit of a slip, and then gradually you kind of fall off the tooth completely. And if you do this, then obviously you're not putting very much gas into the tank and your restoration may fail. So pay attention when you light curing. We do have some tips on how to do light curing that are available from this website. And I'll just kind of go through them here just to kind of summarize them. So we start out by making sure that the light is well disinfected. There's a barrier on the end. We read the instructions for use, make sure we know how to use it. We will cure the restoration and not the gums or some other tooth. Make sure we're curing the right tooth. We will cure it from not only the top, but also from the sides if we're doing a proximal restoration. We're going to pay attention. If we need to at the end of it, we're going to make sure that, we're going to make sure that we're not too far away from the tooth. Sometimes due to matrices or difficult access, we might be further away and maybe we can't even get the curing light in. So, if we have an angle or we have a distance, then we'll make sure we go back and cure it again from the sides. You can't actually overcure a composite resin. You can only cook the pulp or damage the gums by delivering too much energy. And then when you finish with it all, you go and clean the light and check the light output on a regular basis. So those are things that we'd recommend that you do when you're doing light curing. With that, if you have any questions on light curing, please don't hesitate to reach out to me. I do have a YouTube channel on this, and also there's my email, so you can reach out to me on that. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Price. Now, it looks like we have a couple of questions. So, one of our questions that we have is, so if I bought a 5-second curing light online, is there any way for me to test and find out if it's a good curing light, or should I just replace it?
Okay, well, the first thing to do is to find out, does it have FDA clearance for use? That's the very first thing you do. So contact the manufacturer, contact the seller, and ask, does it have a 510K? If it doesn't have a 510K, then you shouldn't use it. So if it's not approved for use in your country, then don't use it. End of story. Okay. Nobody wants to have a problem. So do not use an untested, unproven medical device. Now, let's assume it does have a 510K. And let's assume that it's an approved medical device. Then no, you can use a small tip curing light if you want to, but it's important to make sure you cover the entire restoration completely, as I showed in those slides. So just be aware of the fact you might have to, zap it 3 or 4 times to make sure it's fully covered. Watch what you're doing and just pay attention and make sure it's fully covered.
All right, awesome. Sure that answers their question.
Can I just go back and say that there was a final part to that question? Is there a way to test the light?
Oh, yes, sorry.
So there are ways to test the light. There's something called a checkup light testing service that's available from a company called Blue Light Analytics. There's also a dental radiometer you can buy that is called the Blue Phase Meter 2 from Iverclar. And the Blue Phase Meter 2 is an excellent radiometer that measures both the radiance and the power. And I always like to use it in the power mode because the tip diameter is, it introduces a large degree of uncertainty, shall we say, in the number it's producing. But if you use it as a power meter, I've tested it and other researchers have tested it. It's actually a pretty reasonable power meter. Now, when you consider it, it's going to cost you about $350 to buy one. It's $350 to $400, somewhere in that region, depending on what kind of relationship you have with the sellers. But if you're lucky, they might even give you one for free, but I won't say that too loudly. But seriously, it's a good thing to have a good meter. I do not advise buying some of the cheaper meters. Find them very unreliable. The only one that I would say is a half decent meter is the Blue Phase Meter 2 or the checkup device. Those are the two I'd go for.
What about the meters that sometimes come on the bases?
Okay, that's a really good question, because the meters that come on the bases actually usually work pretty well, especially if they have a digital readout of a number. I like those. If they just got colors like yellow, green, red, or something, I don't like those so much, because you don't have a number, you just have a color to go by, and you don't know how close it is to being, in the red zone. So I'd be very careful about using something that just has colors. But if it has numbers on it, that's great. And what I would do is when you get your light, I would measure it. And then if it's on the base, then, hey, every day you can just stick it on and just make sure it's performing, because when these LEDs go, they actually go very quickly. And if you don't believe me, I mean, I'm sure you've all had LED lights at home or Christmas lights, things like that. They seem fine, no indication of any problems. And suddenly you turn them on and, wow, you can see they're not as bright as they were before. And then give them a couple more days and then they're dead. So you do see that with these lights. They actually do, they do die on you. And it's just important to make sure you test them on a regular basis. People will often ask me, Dr. Price, how often should I test them? And my answer to that is, how many patients do you want to recall? And I say, what do you mean by that? And I say, how many patients do you want to recall whose fillings you've placed that weren't properly cured? Okay, is it a month? Is it a week? Is it a day? So, if you have something on the base, then it's so easy just to go and test it every day. You just put it on and test it, and hey, it's working fine. True story this. I went to a dental practice. They were having some problems with their light, and kind of everything look fine. And I, tried the curing light, and it gave an output that was 50 milliwatts per centimeter squared. It was really, really low. And I couldn't understand why the light was so low. And I found out what had happened was the dental assistant had dropped the curing light on the floor and had actually super glued the light guide back. And they'd done a wonderful job of super gluing it back, but it totally messed up the light output. And I mean, I could not see with my eyes that that wasn't working right. When I looked really, really closely at the base, I could see some kind of traces of glue there, but it was a really good job she did. But unfortunately, I don't know how long the dentist had been using that light, but they were saying they were having problems with sensitivity and debonding. And I said, well, that's probably the reason why. So test the light on a regular basis. The reason, by the way, that I say that if the curing light has a tester in the base, that's great. But don't expect that tester to work well on other lights. Mm-hmm. Because of the wavelength difference that I showed you between the different lights, the manufacturer very sensibly optimizes the output, or optimizes their tester to the output from the curing light that they make. They don't optimize it to brand Z. So that's why it does a great job of measuring the output from their light that they sell it with, but not from other lights. So don't look at that and say, hey, buddy next door, their light is twice as good as mine on this meter, but it's a different light. Okay.
Great. All right, we're getting low on time. So just a couple quick questions. Let's see. So another one we have here is, if you're curing through your clear or a blue matrix for anterior teeth, does curing through that clear matrix have any effect?
Yes, it does. It's about a 10% reduction.
Okay.
So we've looked at that and it's about 10%. So that means if, now the thing is, what do you do about that? Well, if you're curing for 10 seconds, the light doesn't go for 11 seconds. So you just kind of have to hope that that's going to be enough if you finish at 10, or you might just zap it again from a different angle and that kind of does the trick. But yes, it's about a 10% reduction. And you can actually very easily test that for yourself by putting the matrix over the sensor on the light meter. Mm-hmm. And you can actually do a quick laboratory test yourself to see what the effect of the matrix is, or the effect of the barrier that you're using, if you're using a barrier of the end. Again, a good barrier is going to be about 5 to at the most 10%. Some barriers on the market actually cut down the output by 30%.
Oh my gosh.
30% reduction by some barriers. So you have to watch out for that.
So gray market barriers too.
Well, possibly, yeah. Now I can tell you that the barriers that come with the lights that, like Dentsply or Ivoclar or Ultradent, they're all just fine. No problems with those at all.
All right. And I don't know if this falls into your spectrum, but if the light is starting to get hot, if you start to notice you're curing lightning hot, is it still okay as long as you're getting that same output, or do you think, it's getting hot, that might have some effect?
Well, the reason why it's getting hot is because it's not very well heat sunk. In other words, the heat's not being dissipated from the LED chip very well, and probably the manufacturer is really overdriving that chip to give a high output. It's not a good idea, because as the LED gets hotter, the output goes down. And again, that's very easy to test on a dental radiometer. You just run it until it gets hot and you can see it's going to decrease. Mm-hmm. The other thing we have to watch out for, in the FDA test and in Health Canada testing, they actually, one of the requirements is the body shouldn't exceed a certain temperature. And good companies, again, like Ultradent or 3M and such like, theirs don't do that. But some budget curing lights, obviously, that haven't got approval, haven't had that tested, and some of them can get very hot indeed. So there are two parts to that, is that it shouldn't happen on a good light. If it does, it could mean the electronics are bad. But it could also be that you're using it for a long time. And if you read the instructions for use on some of these curing lights, so they'll actually say not to be used for more than 2 minutes continuously, Some of them would even say 1 minute continuously. And then they actually say you have to leave it for 2 or 3 minutes to cool down before using it again. But there are standards in place to prevent the body from getting too hot.
That's really important to note in this day and age when a lot more general dentists are placing clear aligners and doing the buttons.
Yes.
And you can be running that light for a really long time mm-hmm. with the buttons.
Yep.
So
in that case, if you're doing that, I would really recommend getting a good quality light. Just remember, if you've got a small tip, your aim's got to be really good. If you're using it for a short amount of time, your aim has to be really good. And, there's a lot to be said for getting a lower irradiance light, but still delivering a high power over a larger area. So it's a lot more forgiving than a small tip light.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much for your time, Dr. Price. And if you have any questions, you can contact Dr. Price at his email that's on the screen, or you can go to connect@dentaladvisor.com with any questions that you might have. Thank you again, Dr. Price.
Thanks for this opportunity. Thank you.